Hello and Namaskar. Welcome to NCERT's Live Interaction. This is Simran Singh. You are watching us through PME Vidya channel number 10. Or you can also connect with us through our YouTube channel, as you all know is NCERT Official. In case if you have any doubts, any queries, you feel like asking anything to our experts, then you know that we have our contact number for you. Please reach out to us at the number that is there on the screens, 8800440559. Besides, as the session is for class 10th, so our official mail ID for class 10th is dth.class10@ciet.nic.in. And today's session is going to be very interesting, as it is based on economics for class 10th. And our topic of discussion is money and credit. Now, I know this seems very fascinating. So, to make it more comprehensive for you, we are also joined by an expert in the studio. We have with us Ms. Aishwarya Taneja ji. Namaste, ma'am. Swagat hai aapka NCERT mein.
Thank you so much.
Ma'am is HOD Economics from Bal Bharati Public School, has joined in from Dwarka, and she's here in the studio with us. Now, let's learn more from ma'am what we'll be studying in today's session. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Simran. Thank you so much. And a warm welcome to everybody who is watching this live session on YouTube and eVidya channels. Yes, money. The topic is money and credit, chapter 3 of class 10th. So when we talk about money, we are talking about something which has a magical property of multiplying itself. So money can buy everything, but still money isn't everything. So you can understand or you can feel that yes, it's a fact, money cannot buy your happiness, but to an extent money does is able to satisfy most of our needs. So we will be going through a PowerPoint presentation, going through chapter 3 of NCERT and looking at various forms of money, modern forms of money, the metallic money, the check as a form of money, and how banks are useful when we talk about money, and how we can use money as a medium of exchange. There will also be a very interesting discussion on barter system, which is based on double coincidence of wants. So we will have the discussion as we proceed. So let us go through the presentation for now.
So we have our presentation on the screen on money and credit, and yes ma'am, you may proceed ahead.
Thank you so much. So money isn't everything, but everything needs money. So it is definitely a fact. Yes, everything needs money because we need money to buy things. Yes, money cannot buy maturity, money cannot buy happiness, but definitely money is able to a large extent help us in buying lot of things. So how come money became a medium of exchange? Because there was a need to exchange products, there was a need to exchange services, and as a result of which money emerged as a medium of exchange. Now what happens is, what does money do? Money eliminates the need for double coincidence of want. Now what is double coincidence of want? Double coincidence of wants is that a person, two people would require same thing at the same time. Like if I need wheat and another one person wants to sell shoes, then I should be needing shoes and the other person should be willing to sell me wheat. Now this is something which is very, very complicated. So money eliminated the need for double coincidence of wants, which is also known as barter system. Money is widely accepted. We know that if we go to a shop and if we say that no, instead of giving money, let me provide you with some kind of a service, or maybe let me give you something in return for what you are offering me, that is something which is not possible. So money eliminated the need for double coincidence of wants, and it is also widely accepted. You go to a shop, you give money, you buy a thing, you want a particular service, you want somebody to work for you, then what do? You simply have to ask for the, you give the money and you get the service, or you want to buy a product, you give the money and you buy that product, or if you want to sell a product, you get money and then you are able to sell the product also. So money is widely accepted as a medium of exchange. Now one thing we, each one of us has to remember, that when we are talking about money, save more but definitely invest better. Your money has to earn for itself. Your money should not be kept in a locker. Your money should not be kept at home where it is not useful. Money has to be kept in a bank so that you can save it and also invest so that at a later stage you can use money. And that is a unique property of money, that it tends to multiply itself. Because when you save in a bank, what will happen? You save in a bank, you will earn rate of interest over it, and when you if you are keeping it at home, the rats might eat your money, or maybe you might just lose your money. So that is something which is not acceptable, which we must not do. So save money definitely in the bank, but invest better. Make sure that you invest your money at a place where your money provides for you, provides for itself. So what is money? So money is any item that is widely used and accepted in transactions involving the transfer of goods and services from one person to another. That means that if you want to buy a particular product, if you want to engage somebody in a service, you have to use it as a medium of exchange. You are using it as a medium where you can, you know, buy or sell a particular commodity or a service. So this is money. So money, very famous couplet about money is, money is a matter of function 4. Now what are those functions? A medium, a measure, a standard, a store. It's as simple as that. So money is a medium of exchange, and we have discussed at length that how money as a medium of exchange helps us in making transactions and in exchanging of products. Now when it comes to money as a measure of value, now when we talk about measure of value, what are we saying? We are allotting, we are giving value to a particular product or service. Suppose I want to buy a chocolate. So if I want to buy a chocolate and chocolate is of rupees 10, then I am giving that chocolate a value of rupees 10. So if my friend, if I have to, you know, exchange it, if I my friend wants to buy, take a chocolate from me, I will say I am giving you a chocolate which is worth rupees 10. So that is measure of value. So money gives us that measure of value for a particular product or a service. Like if we hire a sub person for a particular task, what do? That I'm going to pay you 500 rupees per hour, or maybe 1000 rupees per hour, or maybe 2000 rupees for a day. Now this is just assigning a particular value to the service that you are engaging that person is. The third function of money is standard of deferred payment. So money as a standard. Now if you want to sell somebody that look, I cannot pay you today, but after a period of 1 month or maybe after 1 year, I would like to give you 1000 rupees. So standard of deferred payment. Now what is deferred? That is delaying the payment. So money has this property. This you couldn't do when there was barter system. Like if you would say that now this time, you know, since my cow is not very comfortable, so let me give you this cow after a period of 1 month. Or maybe if you are exchanging mangoes for that person, you would say ki nahi, not now, let me give you mangoes after a period of 1 month. So mangoes will not be of same quality as they are of now. So this, because mangoes is a perishable commodity. And similarly for cow, the cow may die, may get infected by a disease or something. So the value will not remain same. But when it comes to money, it's so much easy to delay the payment. You can take a loan, you can pay later on, or even if you have taken a loan from your friend, you can always give it at a later date. So now last function of money is the store of value. Yes, money acts as a store of value. That if you want to give it at a later date, money must be able to be reliably saved, stored, retrieved, and to be usable after a period of time. So once again I repeat, money is a matter of function 4, a medium, a standard, a measure, a store. So now we discuss briefly about barter system, which is given there in your book also. So what is barter system? Barter system is that you are exchanging goods for goods, you are exchanging service for service. So barter system, what does it want? Barter system means that you should have double coincidence of want. So if somebody wants to sell shoes and another one wants wheat, unless and until they have a mutual consensus, unless and until they want, they have to exchange the same products, there will not be any exchange between them. So this is a biggest disadvantage of barter system. However, this is something which we all should know and must know, that barter system still exists when it comes to business to business, or business like I have a raw material, I have sugarcane as a raw material and you have wheat as a raw material, and we need to exchange these products for to make a third product, then that is a place where barter system still exists. And even in when we are talking about in terms of employment, there are many instances where people have now started giving perks, which is wages in kind. So that is also a kind of a barter system. So barter system is not entirely non-existent, but yes, medium, money as a medium definitely serves as a better way of exchange of goods. So let us look at certain advantages and disadvantages of barter system. So you see a good, you get a good in exchange, you are happy, so your needs are satisfied immediately. It is a very simple system. You don't have to worry about the rate of interest, you won't have to worry about going to a bank, you don't have to worry about several wallets that you have, you don't need to have a credit card, nothing of that sort. It's a simple system. You need a particular good, the other person is willing to give that particular good, so you are able to exchange the commodities. So it satisfies your needs immediately, and that is barter system. However, like somebody might say, my cow is, you know, I mean, somebody wants to exchange cow and two dogs and say my cow is worth 2.5 dogs. Now this is absolutely absurd. How do you give 2.5 dogs? You can give 2 dogs, you can give 3 dogs, but definitely not 2.5 dog. How do you get a half dog? So that half dog, that means in a barter system, there are certain goods which you cannot divide. That is, indivisibility of certain goods is the biggest drawback of barter system. You cannot, like I gave you the example earlier, you cannot delay the payments. That is, there is a lack of deferred payments when it comes to the barter system. So barter system is definitely a simple system. It is it give you immediate satisfaction, but then the problem is double coincidence of wants and lack of deferred payments. And that is the reason money started becoming major medium of exchange, and it is widely now accepted as for the transaction of various goods and services. So modern forms of money. So now that we know that barter system of course can exist at a very, very lower level, and it can exist there, but still we need money as a medium of exchange. So there were several modern forms of money because everybody was exchanging products. There were products, there were services, and everybody wanted to do not, there was a problem with the barter system in terms of double coincidence of want. So but everybody wanted to exchange goods because everybody was not self-sufficient. So as a result of which, modern forms of money emerged. So modern forms of money, we started with Tughlaq coins, then there were Gupta coins, then there were, you know, gold mohurs, and they started stamping the commodity coins, that is the coins of value, gold, silver and copper. They were basically used for these, or maybe even rock, and they were seashells. They all were used for exchanging of money. Then we look at the metallic coins. Now metallic coins were made from the precious metals like gold, silver and copper, and symbols gave it a standard pressure of value. right? So because symbols, because they were symbols, you would know they were from which kind of, which country, which place, and how they can be exchanged with one another. Metallic coins, easy to store, and soon we realized that it's not easy to have gold, silver and copper coins because it was expensive, and they were then replaced with cheaper metals like stainless steel. Then modern forms of money. So paper notes and coins, first metallic coins, and then we have paper notes and coins. Now paper notes and coins accepted as a medium of exchange because the currency is authorized by the government of the country. So if you are at home and you are looking at this video, what do you need to do? You need to take out the 2000 rupees note or maybe any note that you have. So what is it written on the note? It is written, main dharak ko itne rupay dene ka vachan deta hoon, and it is signed by the governor of RBI for a simple reason, because this money is legal tender. Now what does a legal tender mean? That it is authorized by the government of India that this much of money, this much of amount which is written on it will be given to you if you present this particular note. So that line is very very important, ki main dharak ko itne rupe dene ka vachan deta hoon. So please do look, since you are at home. So Reserve Bank of India issues currency notes on behalf of the central government, and central government has to mortgage same amount of gold with the RBI to ensure that this much of currency is issued by the RBI. So first form of money is metallic money, modern form of money, and then we have notes, paper notes and currency. The third form of money, which is very important, and during COVID-19, this pandemic that we have all been through for almost 1.5 years now, we all have realized how important it is to have cashless transactions. So banks are definitely important and they offer us many other services, but yes, if you want to have cashless transactions, I mean when you do online shopping, when you go to a shop also, we are all using Paytm wallets, we are using Phone Pay, we are using Google Pay, we are using Amazon Pay. So for all this we need to have money in the bank. So banks play a very very important role when it comes to modern form of money. So those deposits which we do with the bank are known as checkable deposits, or you can also call them demand deposits. Now why they are called demand deposits? Because when you go to a bank and you want particular amount, you can simply write a check, you give it, you present it in the bank, and the bank will give you that much of money. Another thing that you can do is, because it is a modern form of money and it is authorized by the government of India, you simply need to, you can give it to any vendor also, or with the parties, if you want to make a payment for a particular product, you simply need to give the check and the check is honored and your money is paid. And that is the reason deposits with bank is also considered as money. So which is very very important. So banks accept deposits and also pay an amount as interest on the deposits, and people also have provision to withdraw the deposits from the bank. So this is a check, you can see on the screen. So check, what does a check do? Yeah, you can write the amount in words, you can write the amount in numbers, then there is, and you can see IFC code on the top, there is account number, and then you sign in the end also. So the facility of checks against demand deposit makes it possible to directly settle payment without the issue of cash, which means bank perform both clearing function and transfer function. Now this is not there in your book, but you still must know that when it comes to clearing function, like two banks have issued the checks, and if it is of same amount, instead of, you know, one bank sending money to another, suppose the amount is of 10,000 rupees, so instead of sending rupees 10,000 to the other bank, banks clear it within themselves, and that is known as a clearing function of bank. So but if the amount is not same, then there is transfer of money. So checkable deposits, demand deposits, is the third form of modern money. So now we know that we have three forms of money. Number one, which is metallic money. Number two, which is the currency paper and coins, and number three, which is the demand deposits. And you all must know that check is a very, very important property. You should keep it safe and you should not be handling it, mishandling it rather, or giving it just blank checks signed to anybody that you know. Right? So this is very interesting. It's a fun fact. So Uday Kumar Dharmalingam is the designer of the rupee symbol that we see everywhere these days. So this is something which you all must remember. So we have two types of money. Okay? We have commodity money and we have fiat money. Now earlier what we used to have? Commodity money. Commodity money is what? Where, you know, if you have a copper coin, so instead of giving a copper coin to the dealer, what do? You simply melt copper, provide that person with the metal, and if that copper coin is worth 50 rupees, you will get 50 rupees in return. That is commodity money, which means that it is worth the metal that is in there. But when it comes to fiat money, the currency that we use in everyday life, which is your coins, which is your rupees, they are all fiat money because they have face value. So if it is written 10 rupees over there, then your money is worth 10 rupees. If it is written 2000, then it is worth 2000. So the money that is in circulation in our country is called fiat money. And earlier times when we used to have gold coins, copper coins, then we were talking about commodity money. Right? So this is something very, very interesting. You can get the coins and find out that where has your coin been minted. Okay, so if there is no dot below the number, below the year, then it means that your coin has been minted in Kolkata. And there are also many other things that you can, if the special marks below the year indicate where your coin has been minted. So if it is a diamond shape, then it means that it has been minted in Mumbai, and if it is a star shape, then it has been minted in Hyderabad, and if there is a dot mark, then it's very near to Delhi, then it is minted in Noida. So these are the loan activities of banks. Like I said, that banks, the primary purpose of the bank is of course to accept deposits, but it is also to give loans. So we are very much concerned about loan, and like you read in your chapter 1, that a country can progress only if it has cheap and affordable credit. So that, for that purpose, banks play a very, very important role. So banks, whatever deposits that the banks receive, they do not lend the entire portion. Like currently, now SLR, that is the reserves that the banks have to keep, is around 24%, which means that if the bank receives 100 rupees as deposits, banks cannot lend entire 100 rupees. Bank has to keep a certain portion of the deposits with the RBI, and rest of the amount they can lend. Now, how do banks earn money? What do banks do? Banks charge a higher rate of interest on the loans that they give, and they give a lower rate of interest on the savings deposits. Now, as a result of which, whatever is the difference, that is the profit of the banks. Banks earn money through various other means also. You all must have seen banks buy shares for you. Banks have, you know, auxiliary services, like banks look into your investments, banks provide you with insurance. So there are a lot of various other auxiliary activities that banks do. But the basic way of earning money for banks is the difference in the interest rates. So banks provide you for the various loans, for maybe for your travel, for your insurance, for your property, for housing, for your car. So banks provide you with loan and charge a rate of interest on it. So the fun question over here is, what will happen if we all reach a bank all together on the same day and want to withdraw our money? right? So it's a question which we all need to ask ourselves, and the answer is there in the presentation, that banks have to keep a certain deposit with the RBI and banks are not allowed to lend the entire amount. So what if our banks goes bankrupt? So this is the question which we can ask ourselves, and there have been instances in our country where banks have gone bankrupt, and the example of that is Global Trust Bank. But RBI is so stringent when it comes to maintaining the rules and regulations and the cash reserve ratio and the statutory liquidity ratio. In our country, generally, banks do not go bankrupt and they are generally merged with a nationalized bank. And when they are merged with a nationalized bank, what happens? The assets and liabilities both are taken over by the parent bank. So nothing to worry. And just one thing, that even if your bank goes bankrupt in dire circumstances, generally it won't, but even if it does, then you are secured for 1 lakh of your deposit, which means that if you have a deposit in a bank and your bank has gone bankrupt, then rest assured, if you have less than 1 lakh rupees, then the bank is it is mandatory for the bank to return you with 1 lakh of rupees. So when you go to a bank to ask for a loan, what all things will the bank ask for? The bank will ask for your collateral. Now, what is a collateral? It is an asset that the borrower owns and uses this as a guarantee to a lender until the loan is repaid. You will be discussing about the interest rate, you'll be talking about documentation, how will you make the payment, whether it will be through NEFT, you'll have to open up an account, what will be the EMI and what will be the tenure of the loan, whether it will be for 10 years, 20 years, 15 years, what will be the amount. So collateral can be land, building, vehicle, livestock and deposits with the banks. So this is a fun fact, that if your bank goes, if you lose your note or if you have torn it, then what will happen? So if it is a rupee 1, 2, 5 or 10, and if you are able to present more than 50% of the note, then you get the full value. If it is a 50 or a 100 rupees, then if you are able to present more than 65%, then also you get a full value.
And I think very interesting facts have been shared by ma'am within our session. And as we are also left by the last 2 minutes, let us quickly take this important question. Ma'am, I would like you to highlight the importance of the currency of a nation. For example, we all know that a payment made in rupees in any part of India cannot be refused by anyone. Just in few words, throw light on that.
Right. Payment in the rupee cannot be refused by anyone in India because rupee is legal tender. Now, as I said, legal tender means that the law has legalized money as a form of payment. Like one day you go to a shop and you say, now I'm going to pay only in dollars. So that person has a right to refuse. But if you say that I have rupee, I have money in rupee currency, then that person cannot refuse to take payment in rupee because it has been legalized by the government of India as a legal tender. That is, you can make payment in rupee.
Thank you so much for highlighting the minute details of money and credit, and our session was for that. And the important point that has been highlighted in the session is save money, invest better. I think that is the most important
absolutely,
part.
Absolutely. Yes.
Whenever we talk about the financial life goals, I think it is an important aspect. And thank you so much, Ms. Aishwarya, for being here with us in the studio and enlightening us about these minute details that need to be kept in mind, apart from the academic aspect also.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much, and thanks to our viewers out there. If you have any questions, as I already informed you, then reach out to us at our contact number or the mail ID that has been provided to you. That is dth.class10@ciete.nic.in. Stay connected to NCRT. We are wrapping our today's session, but we'll be back within a few minutes. Thank you. Namaskar.